Welcome. In this video, I want to talk about content caching on the Mac. Content caching is a service that you can enable to cache downloaded content from Apple services like iCloud, app downloads, updates, things like that. And I have a couple articles that talk about content caching. I'll put a link in the description to these articles. This first one talks about what is content caching, and then it talks about how it works. So if you have, for instance, two iPhones and one of them downloads a system update, it will go through the content cache. The content cache will look at its cache and see if it has that update. And if it doesn't, it will download it through the internet and store it in the local cache and then send it to the phone. Then the second phone that connects will ask the cache for the update, and the cache will have the update and it'll send it right down to the phone. So it doesn't have to go out over the public internet. So this would mostly be useful for applications where you have multiple devices. So in our house, we have probably a half dozen iOS devices and a couple Macs. It's not the most ideal situation for using cache, but it does help a little bit, as I'll show in just a minute here. This would really be helpful for a school or, say, a hotel if you want to cut down your bandwidth or just even provide a service to your customers or the people on the network. This next article has the content types supported by caching service. So it has them split apart by macOS. It does the macOS updates and internet recovery images. So this internet recovery image is interesting because if you support multiple Macs and you're using the recovery system where you download the image from the internet, this will speed that up if you're dealing with macOS 10.13.5 or later. This way, you download it once, it caches it, the next time it does it quickly, because that can take quite a while. It also does apps and app updates from the Mac App Store, GarageBand downloadable content, iCloud data caching, photos and documents, and Apple Books content. That's on macOS. And then iOS 7 and later, and Apple TV, it does iOS updates, Apple TV updates, iOS apps, Apple TV apps, and app updates, on-demand resources for iOS 10 and later, and tvOS 10 and later, the iCloud data caching, photos and documents for iOS 9. So if you have multiple devices that are downloading, say, photos and documents, that will speed that up, which could be pretty handy, especially if you have like a phone, an iPad, a couple Macs, things like that. And then the iTunes U course materials and Apple Book content and certain mobile assets such as Siri high quality voices, language dictionaries, and more. That article kind of tells you what is cached. And then this third article talks about statistics on caching. So what I'll do next is show you how it's enabled. If you go to the system preferences and open that up and click on sharing, you'll see content caching down here as an item, and you just check that. Now, if you're using an old Mac, an old system, you can enable it. You can buy macOS Server, which is like $20 in the App Store, and then you can enable content caching using that. But if you can update to Mojave, I think High Sierra also had this, then you can enable content caching there too for free. You don't have to buy the server. You have an option here. It says cache all content or only shared content or only iCloud content. So if you choose shared content, you'll see it says store shared content such as app software updates on this computer. And if you choose iCloud content, it says store iCloud content such as photos, documents on this computer. So I've chosen all content. And then options here, you can choose how much you want. So you can do the slider here. So I have 102 gigabytes and it says I'm using 43.87 gigabytes. And then you can reset that. So I'll hit cancel there. So I've already had this set up. I'm not setting it up new. And then if we go to Activity Monitor, and this is where you look at how much CPU and memory is being used by your system. If you have caching enabled, you'll see a little cache tab over here. And if you hit that, it'll give you statistics here. So it'll say in the last hour, last 24 hours, last 7 days, and last 30 days. We look over the last 30 days here. It says data served to clients, and it served up the 15.98. Data served from cache was 6.47. So it's about a third of the data has been served up from cache. And then 9.52 has been served from the origin, which means it was downloaded. So, you know, I'm gaining 6.47 here. It's not a tremendous amount, but I have the computer, it's running, I might as well just turn it on. And I have the storage on the computer. Now, if you are in a school, for instance, you might actually buy a Mac Mini and set it up for this. And you just max out the cache if you're doing that. If you're just using it for caching, probably the best thing to do would be to find a used Mac and just tuck it in a corner, turn it on, turn caching on, and have it do the caching for you. Like an old Mac Mini would be perfect for this. And you could even hook in a bigger hard drive if you wanted to store. But you'd probably want to monitor how much you're using. They do recommend using the computer connected to Ethernet, to gigabit Ethernet. You can also plug in two computers or more. You can use multiple computers. And they talk about in this document here, like if you're on different networks, you can, like right here, it says, can I have more than one content cache? You can hook in multiple computers and they'll talk to each other and work together. You can set these up on more complicated networks too. There's command line options and things like that once you dig into it. I'm just talking about the basics of caching in this video. This is all I have for you guys on content caching, but if you have any questions, please leave them in the comments. If you like this video, please click like. I would appreciate it if you could subscribe to my channel, and thanks for watching. Until next time, goodbye.